Thank you and welcome to everybody. You have a great turnout tonight. I think you're going to really enjoy this session. My name is Michelle Waymeyer and I am the supervisor of our Community Prosecution Division for the Prosecutor's Office. I've been at the Prosecutor's Office since 1993 and in Community Prosecution since 1996, and I see some familiar faces here in the room, so it's really good to see all of you. Please help yourself to the refreshments. We're going to go straight through tonight without a break, so if you have to get up and get more pizza. And speaking of pizza, special thanks to the Ryan Baker Foundation for supplying us with wonderful pizza. Kudos to them. Restrooms are outside the door. Our speakers tonight are great with answering questions as they come up, so feel free to ask questions. If we feel like we're getting bogged down a little bit, we may try to hold some till the end or after they finish up. We need to wrap up and get out of here by 7:30, so we will get on the move. We have a very interesting topic tonight and very timely for a lot of things that we see in the city, and it's crisis intervention in behavioral health. And we have two experts in this field tonight that I am proud to introduce, Linda Lynn and Sergeant Catherine Cummings. I'll tell you a little bit about these two wonderful ladies. Linda is a crisis specialist with Eskenazi Midtown Community Mental Health. She's a member of Midtown Mobile Crisis Team. She's worked in a variety of mental health settings over the past 40 years. She started when she was two, to include inpatients, psychiatry, community support clinic, outpatient counseling, state hospital liaison, and crisis intervention. Linda lived and worked in the exciting place of New Zealand for 4 years. I think she should take all of us with her to there. She's active with disaster response and is a part of District 5 Mental Health Disaster Team with the Indiana Department of Mental Health and Addictions. She has her master's degree in community counseling from Butler University. She's a licensed mental health counselor, a licensed clinical addictions counselor, certified practitioner of psychodrama, group psychotherapy, and sociometry. So welcome, Linda. And also my pleasure to introduce my friend Catherine Cummings. Catherine's a sergeant with the IMPD, and she's been with IMPD as a police officer for 17 years. She's been assigned to many divisions in the police department. Probably a lot of you have seen her on television as the face of IMPD and the PIO division. She spent a lot of her time in the investigative division. She served over 5 years in homicide. She worked in missing persons. She worked in sex crimes. She was an investigator in the criminal side of professional standards, the internal affairs division of the police department. And now she is a supervisor of the newly created behavioral health unit. Sergeant Cummings holds an undergraduate degree in journalism and speech communications, a graduate certificate in homeland security and emergency management, and a master's degree in business psychology. She serves an adjunct faculty position for IU at the Columbus campus. So we got some people that don't have any qualifications to talk to you tonight, so we just pulled a couple people off the streets. No, it's actually my pleasure to introduce both of these ladies. Before we start, Catherine has a giveaway question, so trivia, so come on up here.
So we're going to get into this a little bit, but for those of you, Alan, can you hear me okay? Okay. Just so you know, Alan has tethered me to this podium today for this, and that's usually not how I like to talk, so. For those of you who went ahead and looked at your handouts, you have a better chance of getting this, being able to answer this question. So, between an immediate detention and an emergency detention, which one can the police and do the police often do?
First hand up.
Yes. There we go. We're ready to go. Okay. Can everybody hear me okay? I usually project pretty well. I've kind of got a big mouth. So if for some reason you can't hear me, just raise your hand and let me know, and I will speak up a little bit more loudly. As I said, I'm usually a walker. I see a lot of familiar faces in here tonight, so some of you already know that about me. I tend to walk around the room, but tonight I'm going to have to focus on staying in this general area. We are here to talk about what we're currently doing with behavioral health with the police department. This is a timely, timely issue. I'm sure that every time you turn on the TV, there is something on TV, on the news, about mental health, substance abuse, and how it is related to crime. Am I right?
Yeah.
So you probably have a lot of questions about that. And Ms. Carver, I think you and I have been emailing back and forth, too. And I left you a voicemail message about mental health.
Correct? Okay.
Yep. Yes, we have. So I am very excited and honored to be the supervisor who's creating the newly established behavioral health unit. This is a unit that we started on June 6th, I believe, was the first day that the unit started. I've been doing it full-time now since about mid-August. What that consists of, and I think that this is already turned on. There we go. It's, as you can see, five officers who are partnered with a licensed mental health clinician from Eskenazi Midtown. And they are housed on five of the six service districts. Do you want to do another giveaway?
We can.
All right. Can anybody name the six service districts of the IMPD? I need a hand. Go ahead.
Northwest, west, northwest, north, downtown, east, southeast, and southwest.
We have a winner. And we'll do the rest of them at the end, right? Okay. She's absolutely right. We have six service districts, and the officers and their partners are housed on five of those six service districts. We are on North District, Northwest District, Southwest, Southeast, East, and North. We're not on downtown. However, we do take runs and we do help out with downtown. Some of you may be familiar with Sergeant Hipple, maybe? Sergeant Hipple and his flex team on downtown, and they do a lot of work on downtown still with the homeless population. We help out, we just don't have an officer and a clinician assigned full-time to downtown. So we've been, like I said, we've been doing this since June, and this is, I have to give a shout out to both IMPD and Eskenazi, because these are not grant-funded positions. These are full-time staff personnel for each of these organizations. And both organizations feel strongly enough about what is happening and what needs to happen that they have devoted, right now, five people from each organization, well, six including me from IMPD, to this group. So I think that says a lot about how IMPD especially, I'll speak for IMPD because obviously I'm with IMPD. Yes, ma'am. You can't hear me? Is that better? Okay. So it says a lot about IMPD and Eskenazi's dedication to this belief. Anyway, what are we doing? We are going out every day and we're talking to folks in the community. The officer and his partner, it's all men right now, men and me. The officer and his partner, they follow up with people who have been taken to the hospital as an immediate detention. And we had that question earlier. And you have the paperwork that gives you the definition for an immediate detention. Does anybody want to talk to me about what an immediate detention is? Anyone? Okay. Immediate detention. Sometimes we will get phone calls at 911 and someone will call and say, my family member is not acting like he or she normally does, not taking care of himself or herself. Can you come out and do a welfare check? Can you make sure everything's okay? So we'll send officers out and they'll talk to the person and they'll find out, you know what, maybe they do need some medical attention. Maybe they haven't been eating properly or taking their medication properly. So we'll take them to the hospital. Sometimes they don't want to go, but we can, through this immediate detention, we can take them to the hospital. It's not an arrest, but we can take them to the hospital for a medical evaluation. So when that happens, our officers and clinicians right now, and Linda can talk to this because she does it every day, our officers and his partner go out
and just touch base with people when they get home. Touch base with the person, touch base with their family if they live with someone. Find out if they're following up on their medications, how they're feeling, what they're doing. Is there anything that we can do to help them out? And Linda will be able to tell you this a lot better than I can because she does this every day. But I know when I go out with the officers and we knock on the doors and people see us, because I wear this every day. The officers wear khakis and a polo. They dress like Linda. But I wear this. And just like our officers are trying to change the stigma that surrounds mental health, I'm also trying to change the stigma that goes with this uniform. Okay? So when we show up and they see me dressed like this, we didn't call you. I know you didn't call. We're just here to say, what can we do to help? Are you having problems with your utilities? Are you having problems in the neighborhood? Are you having issues paying rent? Do you need help finding a job or transportation? We do those kinds of things too, okay? So when we show up, it's a completely different interaction than what they're used to. I know we did an outreach, a month or so ago, and we knocked on the door and we walked up, and it was one of my officers, Ethan McGivern, who is, he's huge. In fact, I wanted to take one of his polos and put it on over my uniform because it would have come down to like my knees. We're there with with Cynthia, who does what Linda does, and Ethan and me, and we knock on the door, and the young lady opens the door, and out comes a cloud marijuana smoke too. And here I stand. As I said, remember, I'm dressed like this. It took everything in me. I wanted to say to her, ma'am, I smell it. I don't care. That's not why we're here. So she quickly closes the door, comes outside, and you can tell we just kept talking, you know, talking about why we were there. And it just completely, that look of relief washed over her. But that's not why we were there. And there are certain times and there's things that we can do, but you don't always have to do what you can do, right? Because you can legally do something doesn't mean that's the right thing to do and that's the proper thing to do, correct? So our officers in our unit take that to heart and they follow that a lot. When we do outreach with we do homeless outreach. Sometimes we've done some panhandling outreach. We don't run people for warrants. We don't. Because I believe that if we're there truly in that capacity of offering help and assistance, that we have to build that rapport and that trust, right? Remember, I'm trying to change the stigma of this, too. There are times that we have to arrest people, unfortunately. I say this all the time. If I can go the rest of my career and I never have to arrest anyone again, that will not break my heart. And sometimes an arrest only compounds the problem. And oftentimes, in the people that we're trying to work with now, and we're trying to develop what's the best way to help, if we continuously make an arrest, it's just compounding the problem, right? So, we're trying to find a better way to do it. We're trying to find a way to help everybody solve the underlying problems. Solve what's causing the issues in the first place. Is that fair? I think that's what we're all trying to do, and that kind of why you guys are here too? Trying to learn more and figure out what we can do. Because, is Julie Fiddler still here? Mm-hmm. Where's Julie? Yeah. Julie, how much is it when I put handcuffs on somebody? 786 when I put handcuffs on somebody, not me personally, but someone from my agency puts handcuffs on somebody, $786. That is just law enforcement expenses. That is not court time. That is not housing at the APC or the jail. That is just law enforcement. That is just law enforcement training, equipment, etc. So if we have someone who is suffering from a mental health issue, or is having a social issue, and when I say that, I'm talking about unemployed, homeless, that sort of thing. If we're just spending $786, isn't there a better way maybe to spend that money? What if we spend it on the front end doing something else to maybe help solve whatever is causing the problem in the first place? we're still going to spend that $786 times whatever, right? So we're trying to find a way to be more frugal and prudent and spend our resources in a better way. As taxpayers, does that make you happy? I got one question back there. Oh, and let me say this out loud, right, real quick. We're both pretty flexible. We have a flexible style. I do feel kind of restricted tonight, but we have a flexible style. So ask questions. Yes, ma'am.
Out of curiosity, does that cost change from county to county, or is that strictly IMB's cost?
I am sure that changes from county to county, but that is strictly in Marion County, just IMP, correct?
Correct.
Or any law enforcement agency?
2009 money, because we are in the process of doing a system study that's going to update that, so it's liable to go up.
Because you know that government is always a few cycles behind,
right?
So that is, but that is just IMPD. It honestly, and you're, when you're coming into that, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's going to be salaries, benefits, equipment,
handcuffs, so, bullets, guns, cars, gas, vests.
So those prices, yeah, those prices are going to vary with other agencies. Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. There was another question, hand right there.
So would you also, would your unit also respond to the runs that are dispatched to the fire departments, like mental, emotional runs?
Yes and no. So, but good question. We get dispatched to those runs often. And I'll take it back one step further. We don't always know that a run involves mental health. Because we can get sent to a disturbance, we can get sent to a domestic, we can get sent to a shoplifting, we can get sent to a PI, we can get sent to someone sitting in the middle of the street. You name the run, and it could involve a mental health issue. So we don't always just get a mental emotional, is that what you called it? Mental emotional run with the fire department? Typically, we will both be dispatched, and it probably came to us first. It may go for an ambulance run first, but yes, we're maybe not necessarily my unit, but a police officer will more than likely be dispatched with them. And I say not necessarily my unit because there's only five of them, and they are working their tails off, let me tell you. They are so dedicated and awesome. I have a great, great group of guys. Can you back me up on that? Would you agree with that? She was just telling me how sweet Tracy is, her partner. He is a good guy. But they are working so hard. They do go out on active runs. So they work during the day, and then I have somebody on call in the evenings. Unfortunately, I wish we could respond to every run, but we just can't. And even if they work more than their scheduled hours, it's still not going to help the situation, because they have to have downtime to take care of themselves, and I'm emphatic that they take care of themselves too. But just until we can expand that. But what is out there is CIT training. So that, we'll segue into that. So crisis intervention team training, we've been doing that in Indianapolis since before the merger. Is everybody familiar with, when I say the merger, what I mean by that? Where the Marion County Sheriff's Department and the Indianapolis Police Department merged in 2007 and became the Indianapolis Metropolitan Police Department. I only bring it up because I have to. In this particular situation, I normally don't. And I've been around long enough that I was here before the merge, and people will ask me occasionally, not so much anymore, but they'll ask me, do you, which agency I worked for before the merger? And I'm like, if you don't remember, then it doesn't matter. We are the Indianapolis Metropolitan Police Department now. So CIT training started, we keep going back and forth on this, 12, 13 years ago-ish.
In Indianapolis.
In Indianapolis, yeah.
About
13 years ago. That's kind of when I went through it. I volunteered to go through it 12 or 13 years ago. It's a 40-week intensive course, 40-hour week-long intensive course, where officers get exposed to what to expect when they respond to a run that is involving somebody who is in a mental health crisis. So I had embedded a little video in here, and it didn't come through probably with the security of all of our email systems. So we're gonna see if we can get this to play.
Law enforcement officers are dedicated. Every day they put on a uniform and deal with everything from pesky kids on skateboards to bank heists. And while officers always strive to do their best, sometimes they encounter situations more suited for social workers, like dealing with mental health crisis calls, which is why we have crisis intervention teams. CIT programs teach law enforcement officers how to safely de-escalate mental health crisis situations. In fact, law enforcement agencies that have CIT programs in place have reported as much as an 80% decrease in officer injuries during mental health crisis situations. Not only do CIT programs educate officers, they also bring together community members and mental health care providers to offer convenient options for treatment and to reduce the number of repeated calls for police service, saving officers valuable time. Take the next step in helping your community better respond to mental health crisis calls. Learn more about CIT programs by visiting nami.org/CIT.
So that's just a little brief explanation of what CIT, is. So I'm finishing why, when I say that we don't go out on all the runs. But in about 10 months from now, we will have 50% of the department CIT trained. So while my unit is not out 24 hours a day, seems like we are sometimes, but while we're not out 24 hours a day, there are still CIT trained officers working on the street 24 hours a day. And as I said, almost 50%, and we hope to keep sending that number up. And I had a question. Somebody had a question?
You answered it.
I answered it?
Yep.
What was your question?
What percentage of officers are CIT trained?
Look at that, 50%. So, as I mentioned before, it started about 13 years ago, and then it was mostly a voluntary situation where they put the training announcement out and officers could volunteer and say, yes, this is something I would like to do. Now, we're bringing back all of our recruit classes. After they've completed their field training, they come back for the week-long course. And that's how we're getting everybody through and getting our numbers up. So, Linda, I think, is going to get into the details of how we got here. But how did we get here? How did we get to the point where police and people dressed like me are the number one responders to people who are in mental health crisis? Does that make sense? Does it seem like somebody dressed like me with a gun should show up to deal with somebody who needs medical help? But we've gotten here. Nonetheless, we've gotten here. And it's because whenever there's an issue, I don't care what it is, everybody just thinks immediately, call 911, right? Well, we're 911. I remember when I first got this job and something happened and I'm like, somebody needs to call. Oh, I'm 911. Okay. I gotta figure this out. But that's what everybody thinks. Immediately, something's wrong, something doesn't look right, and we're all for that. You see something, say something, call us. But it's gotten to where the jails are the number one provider of mental health care. That's not what they're designed to do. And police are the number one responders to people in mental health crisis. So I think the community as a whole, and I know that government and law enforcement have taken a step back and said, we need to figure out how to make this work better. So that's why we're doing things like CIT. IMPD has done this, taken the step, and created the Behavioral Health Unit. There are a couple of other jurisdictions across the country who have similar units. Now, the units are all going to be different because state law is different. So it impacts what the police can do in these situations. So I can't just look at LAPD, bring their program back here and just recreate it for the IMPD. We're spending a lot of time. I know a lot of you have seen me out talking. I know Linda knows I'm on vacation right now. But this is so important to me, and being able to talk to the community and talk about what we're doing and find out who else in the community is providing resources, it's so important to me that I came in this evening to do this. So we're getting the word out. That's not why I tell you that. I wanted you to know that it's that important to me. We're getting the word out, we're letting people know what we're doing, and then we're finding out who else in the community is here to help. So we've gotten here because we show up, but now we're training our officers better so they understand that this is not always a criminal issue. The courts understand that this is not always a criminal issue. The prosecutor's office, they know this is not always a criminal issue. And we have been arresting people that we have probable cause to arrest. But again, I go back to, just because we can do it doesn't mean we always should do it, right? So you have all these people looking around going, this really, yes, it violates the letter of the law, but not the spirit. Or this person needs medical intervention and medication and counseling, not jail. So that's what we're working on. We're trying to find better ways to interact with the community, help those who are in crisis, make the police a better resource for that, and try to help solve the underlying issues in our community, which will lead to a reduction in crime. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question.
Skip ahead. Oh, I'll repeat what she says.
I know somebody that's in one of the programs, and they're through the mental health portion of it. My question is, okay, if they have a violation and they have to be time in jail for something.
Are you talking about like a specialty court?
Yes,
okay.
Specialty court. My question is there something coming down the pipe where they will have a separation where they're not in jail property?
I can't speak. What she asked was, she knows someone who is participating in one of the specialty courts. So we do have, I don't know how many specialty courts we have now, but we do have, it was called mental health court, it's now called behavioral health court, that is designed to, it's asking these exact same questions. Okay, we have somebody now who's been put into the criminal justice system who maybe isn't best served by being in the criminal justice system. How do we make this work? And so her question was, she knows someone who is in one of these programs, correct? Mm-hmm. And you want to know if they're going to be separate in the jail population.
Right.
Okay.
Like, if they do their counseling meetings and they have all mm-hmm. the things that they go to, but things happen.
Mm-hmm.
And
absolutely.
And they have those things.
And so, without speaking as an authority on the court, because I'm not, but I do work very closely with the supervisor of who oversees probation for Behavioral Health Court, Veterans Court, and Pair Court. He and I are working and having multiple conversations trying to figure out how our little skeleton crews can work together. Because as you were saying, the goal is not to violate someone who's in that program. The goal is for that person to be successful. So we're working together to figure out how we can use my unit and use his probation officers, not to go out and drop the hammer on somebody, not at all, but to find out, is there something going on that they don't know about that my officers may have information about that we can figure out what's going on so that they are successful. As far as whether there's going to be separate populations within the jail, I don't work for the Sheriff's Department, so I cannot answer that question. I do know that through conversation that the Sheriff's Department, they are also looking into behavioral health and mental health issues within their population. So all of the law enforcement agencies are having these conversations and these discussions. Does that help a little bit? But what I can tell you, I can't talk about the population separation, but I can tell you that that's one of the things that my unit is looking at, is finding, helping the people who are in those programs be successful. Okay, does that answer it a little bit?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. So what are our resources? What are our options when we show up, when 911 is called? Well, we can arrest somebody. And as we've already discussed, that sometimes isn't always the best option, right? But when we show up, we do have neighbors who are calling, and we have neighbors who are going, you're not solving the problem. We pay you to solve the problem, we call you to solve the problem. So in all fairness to the officers, sometimes they make an arrest. Yes, they have probable cause to do so, but they do it because they don't have any other resources, any other means of solving the problem, right? So we have someone who needs help, and we have people who need help also because they're calling the police. So it's a balancing act. So we can make an arrest. We can do an immediate detention. And we discussed that, correct? And I think Linda will go into it a little bit more. We can do that. But sometimes we don't have probable cause to make an arrest, and sometimes we don't have, I'll call it probable cause, it's not, because it's not an arrest, but sometimes we can't meet the criteria to do an immediate detention. Then what do we do? That's kind of where we are. You know, we're looking for additional resources. The Reuben Engagement Center is coming online. Julie is intimately familiar with this. So the Reuben Engagement Center is slated to open in January now?
End of the year. I've personally been on that project 7 years, so I'm tired. It cannot open a day soon enough.
But very quickly, the idea behind the Reuben Engagement Center is to have another place where people can go who are fighting homelessness, who are fighting substance abuse issues, who are fighting mental health problems. So we're looking, we are working on it, we are looking for additional resources for the police and for the community. Specialty courts, we talked about specialty courts a little bit. Behavioral health court, veterans court, pair court. The idea behind the specialty courts is, again, yes, there was probable cause to make an arrest and to file the charges, and yes, a crime was committed, but a lot of times people are not best served by being in jail. They don't need punishment, they need treatment and help, right? And support. Pam, yes?
The Reuben Engagement Center, is that something where they would have to pay out of pocket for, or is this something that the community provides to them when they arrive?
It is not out of pocket. And to say it's community, it is being partially funded by the community. It's also grant and a gift from the Reuben family, correct?
Correct.
So it's being funded through a collection of different sources.
Will people ever be turned away from limited resources, or?
I would say in any type of resource, The resource providers that I know, who I have met, they never want to turn anyone away. If people cannot come into a program, and I hesitate to say turn away, because trust me, the people who are providing the resources, that's the last thing they want to do. But if they have limited space, or they have limited funding, or someone doesn't meet the criteria that they have to meet to participate in a program, those would be really the only reasons that I could say somebody would be turned away from a particular program. Does that help?
That does help. If they end up having limited space, would they be able to try and find another location for that person to go to, or is that something that I would need to help with as well for the course?
I don't.
So if the Reuben Center had limited space and they wouldn't be able to take somebody, would you guys then look for another location for this?
We will always look for a solution and a location for someone who needs help, always. The Reuben Engagement Center, it's each resource is going to have very specific parameters of who can go there. Sometimes it may be gender-based. Sometimes some people don't qualify for a program because they're not truly homeless, so they wouldn't qualify for the program. But we have a lot of dedicated people who spend a lot of time, and that's one of the beauties of this new unit, is the officers can spend the time talking with people and finding out what the real problems are, and then connecting them with resources they may not be familiar with. Okay? Got a couple questions. One gentleman back here? Yes.
Yeah, it might help if you tell them it's voluntary versus involuntary, but also where it's located at. Okay.
Would you like me to tell them all that? Reuben Engagement Center will be on the second floor of the Arrestee Processing Center, but let me be very clear, it is not connected or related to the Arrestee Processing Center. That just happened to be open and available space. It is a purely voluntary program. It is not something that we show up and say, it's this or this. It is not that type of program, okay? Does everybody know where the Arrestee Processing Center is?
No.
It is, what's the exact address?
742 East Market.
I'm sorry?
742 East Market.
Sorry to say 700 East Market. 742 East Market Street, okay?
Julie, are you gonna be sticking around after this is over?
Yes, ma'am.
So I Google it, I think this would answer your question. It will have 30 people. And it's actually the secondary place that they would be checking. It's for homeless people who are unable to stay in other shelters because of substance abuse and mental health issues.
And there are multiple shelters around the area. So like I said, when I say that each program and resource provider has their own set of criteria, okay? Yes?
Me or somebody else?
Go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, so I live in Southeast, mm-hmm. and I'm aware that 2004, I think it was, Officer Jay Claire was shot by a man who supposedly was schizophrenic. I'm also aware that supposedly most psychotic people are not violent, but I'm thinking that your program, if it existed then, might have prevented the loss of this particular officer's life. If you had been able to intervene at some point in advance. And maybe his mother would have lived also. But I am wondering what kinds of mental or behavioral issues are eligible for your unit's help. I mean, are you talking autism and psychosis like schizophrenia? Or
the answer is yes.
Or are you, what about people who are... Who are not somehow separated from reality, but they're, have anxiety or okay. OCD or depression, something that's less mild.
Okay, let me address that. Let me address that. So she's asking, I guess, the set of criteria for people to have involvement with the behavioral health unit. We don't have that outlined. We are talking to everyone. So we get referrals from within the department. We have officers who take, as I mentioned before, the numbers of runs that involve mental health. And as they get to know the unit and get to know the officers on their particular district, officers walk in all the time and say, hey, when you have a chance, go check on this address, go check on this person. I think he or she needs some help. So in that situation, we wouldn't have any idea, really, if there's a diagnosis, what that diagnosis is. So we are open and will go talk to anyone. Autism, I just had an email earlier this week from a school who wants us to come in and talk so that some of their students who have autism can interact with police before there's an emergent situation. So we are open to all of this. And that's the exciting part and the hard part of building something new. When you don't know exactly where you're needed and what you need to do, you start to frame it. But you also don't want to get it too big and broad that your five poor officers and their five poor partners are overwhelmed. So we get referrals from within the department. We get referrals. I can get referrals in something like this. I get emails all the time from people. I got your name from somebody. I saw you talk to adult and child. And I get emails, we get referrals that way, from the neighborhood, from community groups, we get referrals everywhere. So we will go out and we will talk with anybody. And yes, you brought up Jake Laird and that whole situation. That really, to boil it down, and I'm gonna hurry up and finish this so that Linda can talk, but to boil it down, that's what we're trying to prevent. We are trying to prevent any kind of negative interaction for someone who is in a mental health crisis, We're trying to prevent any violent interaction with someone between the police and that person for the benefit of that person and the benefit of the police department and the community as a whole. So I think that's a good way to sum it up. That's what we're trying to do. Really small problem, right? Just we can take care of that in a week, right? But that's what we're ultimately working to do and working towards. Okay? One question?
You know, I work in mental health. I work on a detox unit and they have mental health issues. And you guys do a great job. When they first come in, they're mad because they've been brought in. But a few days later, when they sober up and feel better, they say thank you, like it's good. Mm-hmm. And then when they try and reflect on it, you guys are very nice to them.
Good.
When they first come in, they say, oh, he was terrible or what. But then they're like, huh, no, actually it wasn't that bad. So you make my job easier, so thank you.
Oh, well, thank you for saying that. And that is, that's what we're trying to do. That really is what we're trying to do, is get people the help that they need. Okay? I'm going to sit down and let Linda have the floor.
Thank you. Good evening, Community Justice Academy campers. I was thinking, like, is this like the police academy or what? I'm just so excited to see this many people here and the interest in the topic. And I'm going to run through some things, because any of these topics, I could probably spend an hour on each of them, so I won't do that. I want to back up a little bit. Again, thank you, Sergeant Cummings, for helping lead this new collaboration. Back in 2011, my CEO, Margie Payne, with Midtown Mental Health Center, was having conversations with then Commander Brian Roach at Southwest, and we decided to do a pilot project. And so I was placed there half time just to kind of see what's the need. So I did that half time for a year, and then another colleague of mine, Rebecca Bricker, came on half time at that. And then we were following up on immediate detentions, doing homeless outreach with Sergeant Hipple's team. And that has progressed for the last almost a year and a half. I've been full-time. Rebecca and I both worked at the crisis at Eskenazi. So we actually have a team of 7 people, and our mobile crisis team has a kind of a broader, we're focused on IMPD, but we all do also have a public safety focus. We have one staff, Jennifer Schianelli, who's based with IEMS, with the ambulance service. Rebecca is our person down at the downtown district, because that's the primary homeless concentration. Rebecca's a real pro in homeless outreach, and we cooperate with professional blended street outreach in the city. And then we have added in the last year and a half, and until just recently now, we have these other team members on the district. So we have been kind of out there treading water, trying to see, kind of experimental, and so this has all come together really well when IMPD came forward and said, hey, can we give you guys each an officer? We're going, yeah, this is really cool. So we have gone into work. I want to say a couple of things, just kind of my ground rules in talking about mental illness, that we are talking about brain diseases, okay? This is not volitional. These people are not choosing. None of us choose to go out and get depressed. I don't know how many of you know somebody, have a family member who's had a mental illness or struggled with something. Yeah, it's most of us, you know, we may have been there ourselves at times. And a lot of us have family members or we know someone. The other one is we need to be careful, and I'm always reminding myself about this, so this is for me as much as anybody, but we need to be careful about how we frame our discussions. That people are not a diagnosis. We are more than a diagnosis. You know, we still hear that in some medical terms, like she's a diabetic. Well, she has diabetes, but she's more than a diabetic. This person has schizophrenia, but they're, you know, this individual is suffering with mental illness. This person is suffering with substance use disorder. So there's still a lot of phrases and things out there that reinforce that stigma and stereotype. I wanted to talk, oh, I lost the clicker here. So I want to talk about several things, locus of treatment and what's happened over time. Like, how do we get here to where we're at today? And the story of mental health treatment goes way back, and we're not going to go in the way back machine all the way to the Greeks or before that, but the Greeks were on something that they thought a good treatment for mental illness was to sip chilled wine while sitting in a hot bath and having a massage and kind of following hedonism and working on your peace of mind. So what goes around comes around. But we are going to go. We're going to go to. I just want to plunge you really quickly into a quick history here about the treatment of mental illness in Indiana. I want to say Indiana was on the cutting edge. This is great news. In 1827, the legislature voted to build an asylum. Now, they were kind of going on about that, as Indiana does, talking about how we're going to fund this, where we're going to build it. And about 1843, Dorothea Dix was one of those pioneers back in the day who was going across the country talking about humane treatment for mentally ill and encouraging states to build facilities that had some moral and humane treatment. And she spoke at our state legislature. This is 1843. So that put a fire under their feet, and by 1848, they opened what became Central State Hospital. Down on West Washington and Warman. It was locally became known as Seven Steeples. I don't know if you've ever seen the pictures of these very large ornate buildings and these great seven steeples that stuck up. But this was the first asylum in our state. I've heard ranges of population over the years from 3,000 up to 5,000. I don't know if it ever was up to 5,000, but this was a city unto itself. It had a farm, it had everything. It had a dairy, it had the laundry. Food was grown there. It was a city in and of itself. So it was, Central State was in operation until 1994. And I want to say something about the narrative that still goes around in this city, and I've heard this in public meetings, and I want to stand up and denounce this narrative. But I hear people say, well, they just shut the doors and put the people out of the street. No. That didn't happen, okay? And actually, when we talk about downsizing and closures of state hospitals, this started quite a while ago. And it happened most dramatically in the early, well, actually, at the turn of the century, because the state hospitals in this country were full of people with what was diagnosed as paresis. These were people, they were getting, mainly men, they would come in with psychosis and eventually would get paralyzed and they would die and they would spend their lives in asylums. It turns out, and nobody knew it at the time, that this was untreated syphilis that was creating an inflammation of the brain. And so they kind of accidentally discovered this, like, oh my gosh, this is syphilis. So when antibiotics came on board to treat the syphilis early, people were able to not be hospitalized because they were preventing this. So that was one of the first kind of points. But the biggest point was in the early 1950s with the discovery of what became known as Thorazine. Which was the first antipsychotic medication that came down the pike. And it was a game changer. And actually, there's a lot of things in psych, if you look at it, these were accidental discoveries. They were looking for a better antihistamine. Yeah. And they found a heck of an antipsychotic medication. So for the first time, people were able to get better on this medication. They were able to go home. So you saw a start of a decline then, and also in the 50s came along early antidepressants. Again, that was an accident. Amipramine was an accident. They were looking for a better antipsychotic, and they found amipramine, which helped with depression. So this is another big group of people who were hospitalized. And then soon after that, Librium got discovered, and that was one of the first medications that could ease anxiety. So we start to see in the 50s, a decrease of the population. And really before the turn of the century, 1905, Indiana opened four other state hospitals at that time, Evansville, Madison, Richmond and Logansport, all those are still in open to this day, to some degree. So the big game changer too was when lithium came along to treat what was known as manic depression, bipolar disorder. So the big switch, so you got people coming out because the meds are helping them. The last bill that was signed by President Kennedy in October of 63 was the Mental Health Centers Act. And that designated money, federal money, for every state to open community mental health centers. So that was another shift. There were five things you needed to have: inpatient, short-term, outpatient, partial hospitalization, crisis, and consultation education. Over the years, they added addiction services as a requirement and children's special services in 1970. So we originally had 32 community mental health centers. Midtown was the first, was the only one in the state for several years in the end of the 60s. We eventually had 32, and these were catchment areas, like 150,000 population, and pretty strict about the boundaries until the mid-1990s, and the boundaries loosened a bit so people could have more choice. So you started seeing people come out more because we're advancing our medications, our antipsychotics, our antidepressants. They didn't need to be in the hospital. And I can tell you there were people at State Hospital who were there because they had seizures. They were put in there as children because they were disobedient. There were people who were eccentric, a little bit odd, who were put in. There were also people with severe mental illnesses. But people, you know, some people stayed there forever. I was a state hospital liaison for 7 years and was there until 92, went to do another job, and then came back as a consultant, though, as Central started to wind down. And I can tell you, from 92 to 94, every single person was carefully assessed. And by that time, we were getting housing on board. Group homes, supported apartments were starting to come into play. And many people were placed in housing at that time. There were several dozen that no one could agree that needed to be discharged, and those folks went to Lou Carter at the time of the closing of Central. There was a 5-year study done by IU after the fact, didn't find any more readmission, recidivism, anything of the people who were placed out in the community when Central closed. We still have a few people, they're older now, still in the housing that we placed them in when Central closed. And, you know, it's made a big difference in their life to have a, you know, kind of a normal life and not be locked away. So the mental health centers coming on board was a huge game changer. And there's some perfect storms that I want to go over very quickly. Of how did we get here now in this day where we're battling things like homelessness with folks with mental illness, poverty, crime, people getting involved with crime. So the gentrification of the city centers, which really came about in the 1970s, there was an upside to this and a downside. We talk about yuppies coming into the inner city. On the one hand, people came in and revived these inner cities. Derelict buildings and places were restored. I first moved to Indiana in 1975, and I had some friends in Old North Side, and I thought they were just so brave, these pioneers, you know, rehabbing these houses in the Old North Side. And you look, so there was an upside to this. The downside is that housing that had been affordable across this country, and we're talking millions of units, were taken out of the stock. What was a standard, a staple in this country, were called SROs, single room occupancy. And this was, our country was built with people living in SROs. People, workers would come into the city. The old YMCA downtown, that was a single room occupancy. It's like a dorm. They have their rooms, they have a bathroom, share a bath. So they're in a very short time, in the 70s and into the early 80s, there were hundreds of thousands of these units lost. The significant part is that the first wave of people who came out of state hospitals in the 60s, many of them went to SROs. And by that time, the SROs were known to house the most, it was kind of housing of last resort. It was affordable, it was for elderly, low income, and sometimes the most frail of our population were in those settings. So there was this big rug pulled out from under people at that time, and that's when we started gradually then to see the homeless population go up. Both my grandpas were coal miners down in Southern Illinois, and at the turn of the century, they were mining coal down there, and they told me stories of the days when they still had the canaries in the little cages to carry down into the mines to check for the toxic fumes. And I've always, to me, you know, working in mental health, and I love working with people who are the most severely ill, people with psychosis, that's my favorite bunch. But to me, they are the canaries. They are the forerunners. When they start falling over, when things start happening there, then we're in a toxic situation. And that's what was going on early in the 70s, in the late 70s, as we saw this housing go. So you did see, as the mental health centers got on board, more money was coming out for housing, and this was gradually building, but it couldn't keep up with the numbers. Managed care came. I don't know if you remember life before managed care.
Yes.
It sent chills through our spines. But it was a way to cap cost, and costs were out of control. In a 10-year period, our healthcare costs went through the roof for a lot of reasons. That's one of my soapboxes I won't get on. But this had a direct impact on mental health, because suddenly we can't do some of the things we've been doing. We had to get pre-authorization. Number of sessions had to be capped. You could reach a lifetime limit of services. And I'll tell you, the thing with severe mental illnesses, these are illnesses that are recurring. People stabilize, they may decompensate, it's a roller coaster. Mm-hmm. So it's not like we go in and fix it, okay? We're not fixing, we're trying to help people manage illnesses, and we're trying to help people recover to the best of their ability. Managed care had a huge impact on how mental health services were offered, and I'm, you know, there's a good sign and a bad sign. Recession, been there, done that. State, suddenly money's not there like it used to be, both in our own pockets and at the state level, so that was an issue. Our aging institutions, these state hospitals, the buildings took a lot of money to keep up. There were only a few buildings left at Central from the 1840s. They rebuilt, they put some newer buildings in the 70s, but even by the time I was out there into the early 90s, some of those buildings were in dire need of repair, and the state didn't have the money to do it. So the real turning point for me was seeing when street drugs became affordable. At one point, crack cocaine was pretty expensive. It was saved for the, again, these were some of the younger, you know, people making money would go use crack. It was pretty expensive. And then in the early mid 90s, suddenly some of these drugs became a lot more affordable. We'd been through the times with PCP, seeing what that did, thought, well, this is kind of a passing thing. So not only does crack become more affordable, but we're seeing more synthetics on the street. We're seeing more, PCP has made us come back. And I used to say crack was the devil's drug, and then I changed it, well, PCP is the devil's drug. And now every time something comes along, I go, man, that's the devil's drug. You know, so we still see on the street what's known as wet or sherm, which can be either a cigarette or a joint of marijuana soaked in embalming fluid and cut with PCP. And I always think, who was sitting around some night thinking, man, let's try that. Let's see what happens. And what happens is it creates huge psychosis. It causes brain damage. you know, we went and saw a man who had gouged out his eyes in a PCP frenzy and 3 days later didn't realize he didn't have eyes. That's, to me, you know, the embodiment of some of these drugs. And all of you in addictions work, I know you have stories about this, and now we're seeing scarier things. So then we have the other perfect storm of over prescription of narcotics, because this is an unintended consequence by JACO that certifies healthcare providers that at some point control of pain became a marker for healthcare facilities and hospitals. We have to control pain, so doctors prescribe painkillers, which after a while, most of these are addictive. You know, you get dependent on them. So then we reach the point, again, it's a supply-demand thing, where suddenly, then the rules change, feds come in, say, you gotta stop prescribing those, so now the painkillers are too expensive, and we're back to heroin, which is cheap as dirt compared to a lot of other things. And not only heroin, and you've seen this in the news lately with the fentanyl, cutting it with fentanyl and carfentanil that's just deadly. So there's a lot of perfect storms that have helped create where we're at now. And I don't want to sound totally like Debbie Downer. So there are, you know, how to get help for loved ones. This is really the most common question I get. I have a loved one, what do I do if? And, you know, we say to people in a really extreme situation, call 911. The first choice, if you can talk somebody in or get them in for a voluntary assessment, that's always the first choice. That's not always going to work. But to call 911, you can ask for a CIT officer. They can come and assess. It doesn't mean that immediate detention will be done, you know, but they can assess to see if the criteria are met. There's also on your sheet something called an ED, an emergency detention. This requires finding a doctor who will sign a doctor's statement. It doesn't have to be a psychiatrist, but it does have to be a doctor who can authorize admission to a specific hospital. So it's typically a psychiatrist. A family can be the petitioner, and then you take this to probate court, present it, has to be immediate dangerousness to self or others, have a mental illness, or be gravely disabled. Can't be something that happened last week. Has to be in the moment. But it is a way that we use quite often to get people help. Family support. NAMI, you have a brochure, a little blue brochure about NAMI, National Alliance for Mental Illness. They should put me on payroll because I'm always singing the praises of NAMI. They did great educational programs. They have great support groups for families. These are folks that have been in your shoes. And to me, one of the tragic things about some of the more severe mental illnesses is they don't show themselves until young adulthood. So you may have a kid that's doing great in high school. They go off to college, and there's that first psychotic break. And for some people, it's out of the blue. Sometimes you look back and see little signs, but this, you know, people, the families are blown out of the water. And so NAMI is one of those groups that can really be helpful and kind of walk with you through this. Also, thank goodness for the internet now, you can go in and Google about anything you want. I caution people against Googling to look at the DSM-5 diagnostic manual. If you're looking up the diagnosis of your family members or your spouse, or you're trying to look up your own diagnosis, that's probably not a good idea, because we are all on the spectrum of something, trust me. So you need to be careful with that. There's also a handout here on the back that has some resources. The different community mental health centers, the crisis units, where they admit for their inpatient, were severely limited in inpatient beds. That's a fact, Jack. You know, and there's a lot of debate about building, bringing more beds on or not. It's terribly expensive to run these beds, but we're always needing beds, it seems. So, you know, the other thing is if you can get your loved one involved in consumer groups, that's another, been a game changer in this country. We're kind of behind other countries in terms of consumer groups where people who are in mental health treatment are really kind of empowered and helping make changes. I worked in an organization at one point that had a lot of consumers on staff, and it was a huge, it was a big different way of doing business, and I was just, it was refreshing.
Can you clarify what you mean by consumer group? I'm sure you don't mean a coupon.
No, and I will say, I didn't say this at the beginning, but one of, some of the language, whether people want to be called clients or consumers, a lot of folks don't want to be called consumers because that implies a choice of choosing to be a consumer. But the groups that are run by people in recovery or who have mental illnesses are typically called consumer groups. I'm used to working in a hospital. I prefer the term patient because in Latin it means one who suffers. And to me that is an honest statement about many of these illnesses, is the suffering that can go with them. So we have challenges. We still have the stigma, funding. We still have, I think where the pendulum is going to swing back on mental health laws. I have seen in my lifetime where the law swung to totally protect civil rights, and I'm concerned that sometimes the right to treatment is not protected, and it's going to take some political will and a lot of negotiation to find that balance again of how do we help, you know, really help people, and but not force it down, force treatment down their throats. There's a lot of good news. Oh my goodness, the research that's out now, the brain research about what is going on, that we can finally say, yes, these are illnesses. We can't pinpoint many things yet, like to say, here's a marker that we can look at, or maybe find a way to address that, but there's so much research going on. Midtown has a program called PARC, which is an early intervention program for people in first, young people at their first time episodes of psychosis, and trying to interject there.
Is that
PARC? PARC. Yep. We really try to work on the recovery model. Again, this is looking at how we manage illnesses, how we help people be the best that they can to their ability with support. Assertive case management. I mean, there's just tons of stuff here. There's federal money coming in more now, right now, for heroin. IMPD's been a leader, and their officers being trained to issue naloxone, Narcan. They have saved several hundreds of lives in the last couple of years by doing that on the street. There's housing, federal money for housing for homeless. And I just had some figures from Rebecca. I asked her for some figures today. There's several kinds. I won't go into the detail, but permanent supporting housing. This is voucher based on disability, and the most vulnerable from 2014 through this month, they placed 120. This is primarily Rebecca Bricker, who's our downtown person, in conjunction with Andrea Demink, who's with the Poorhouse. POUR, Poorhouse. We've also had the cop force housing. There have been 58 referrals, 37 linked, and there's been 102 people helped into self-pay housing that were homeless. All these people are on the streets. So that is really good news, that in Indianapolis we're trying to get some folks off the streets and get them into treatment. Finally, collaboration. I can't say enough about collaboration, and I think the terminology now, I hear people talking about we're all living in our silos, you know, we need to not live in our silos, but I'm a gardener. So for me, I don't look at silos. I'm familiar with silos, but being a gardener, I look at how hybrids are developed and this cross-fertilization and cross-pollination, and I think of my Shasta daisies I have, which are a hybrid, and they have this great thick stem and this beautiful top, and I think somebody worked really hard to get the best qualities of these different breeds and get them together here into this flower. And I think that that's part of what we do, is in these collaborations. And again, these are based on relationships. Okay, it's not, we need theory, we need policy, we need programs, we need structure, but it still comes down to relationships. And that we're building with the folks who are knocking on their door. Yes?
I got two things to complain about here that you said tonight. I had brain tumor for 5 years and didn't know it. I had taken out, I died. I came back, so I'm the number one bitch. And I play that part too, Betty, I go.
That's okay.
My sister tried to put me in a home. I fought because I didn't belong to them.
Right.
I wanted my home and my family, my friends, my animals.
Right.
Second of all, Indianapolis Police Department is the fantastic people you've ever seen in your life.
Uh-huh.
There's a gentleman that lives on the street down from me, and I do call the fire department quite often and the police because of this. I saw him one night out my bedroom window, tried to kill his mother. He beat that crap out of her, so I can say.
Right.
She ran around. I called the police, and I said, no lights, please. No sirens, because I don't know what will set him off. They came, and they worked for an hour and a half with that young man to calm him down so they could get him to a situation.
Yeah.
And just because he was ill. He is ill.
Yeah.
And then, but he goes and gets treatment. Comes back and does the very same thing.
Right.
He sets the house on fire, he pulls the wires, there's nothing left in the house, not the shell.
And that's what I'm talking about. With the way the laws are now, it's very, very difficult to keep people against their will.
You had brain tumor, that people were stupid and we should go
on. Oh, no, no, no.
Yes, you said you had brain tumor, then you go off with this other thing, you
Brain tumors, neurological conditions are a thing of their own, and that is a total. I'm not even talking about the organic, that kind of organic process going on.
But not know it.
But you know, let me tell you, I admire your spirit of independence, of wanting to live life, call the shots, live it your way, and that's the kind of freedom we're wanting to protect. That's the kind of spunk we're wanting to protect with people. That life force, like, I'm going to live my life by God, and I'm going to do it my way. And
I'm going to work with the police department.
Okay.
I'm going to work in my neighborhood to make it better.
Good.
Half of these people don't know what being in the neighborhood is. Okay. We had a whole truck full came just Saturday morning. Both of them,
well,
they had gotten men and women together, and they were cleaning the street.
I appreciate that in you. Thank you for that. And I sometimes hesitate to say I didn't put on my resume of being a community organizer in the past, because that became kind of a bad term at some point. But that's what grassroots democracy is all about, and that's what we're about, of people having the freedom to speak and the freedom to, you know, have their opinions, and that's great. So let me just say one other thing, and then we're going to take questions about relationships. And I've learned this in many ways over the years. One of the things that sticks out in my mind, when I was at Central State, we had regular staffings, and so every person had to be seen every 6 months, come in with the treatment team. And there was a lady that every time she came, she lasted about 5 minutes. She walked in the room angry, she wouldn't answer questions, she'd been there for years. So she was going to come in one day. We all braced ourselves, like, well, this won't take long. You know, we're sitting there like, okay. She walks in the door, sits down, calm, smiles, starts answering questions very calmly. And this goes on for 10 minutes. And the director of the unit finally said, Mrs. So-and-so, he said, I just have a question. You've never enjoyed these meetings. What has changed? What's different today? And she turned, she pointed to the doctor, and she said, a couple of months ago, I was out on the grounds, this is at Central, I was walking the grounds, and it started to rain, and he came up and he shared his umbrella with me. That one act of building a relationship, of approaching somebody like another human being with compassion, was enough to slightly shift her. So those are the little things that happen in the relationships that you know, we just can't lose track of. So questions. I'm sorry I'm going on a bit. I know you were up a while ago. Yeah.
We're working with in Brownfield area and Butler Tarpon area to develop a relationship of support in our community between what you do and what can help from our community. And one of the things we're working on was how to connect the information between you guys and take it to the community.
Yeah, she's talking about with Crown Hill and is it Butler Tarpon area?
Martin Luther King Center
of getting those relationships and getting the information out there and how to connect better. And I think that's a challenge for all of us. There's so many agencies out there, and you know, we're more than happy to come and meet with you and your group.
She's already working on it.
Okay. Other questions? There was one back here. I'm going to work my way over. Yes, ma'am.
Why is the Service of Mental Health broken out into service areas if I have a physical condition? I have to go anywhere I want to.
Why is mental health broken out into what?
You mean because of the police department?
In Ketchum. Ketchum areas don't exist on paper anymore. The mental health centers still have general areas they cover. Right now, most of the treatment is driven by if you have third-party insurance and who takes what, because every center takes different third-party payers. But that was to encourage people trying to find a provider that they want to go to, rather than saying you have to go there because you live in that geographic area. Yes.
Do they have some kind of resource for somebody, for instance, if you have insurance that can have this crazy high deductible? I had a family member go through this, a severely depressed, suicidal, mm-hmm. and went to get him help. And they said, well, his insurance says he has this deductible, so he has to pay $300 a session up front, so he didn't get the help.
Yeah.
And he ended up setting the house off.
Yeah, this is an insurance that has a high deductible, and the person couldn't get treatment. That is unfortunately part of the reality. But there are services that will do reduced cost in town. Well, they'll knock the cost down, and you kind of have to negotiate that. That's a tragic thing when that happens. Yes, ma'am.
Collaboration. I didn't hear anything about collaborating with faith-based community centers or churches. I was lucky enough to minister to the homeless, which is concerning because I like going to the Central Library, and it's kind of scary. Where can I, as a lay person, as a civilian, get training to learn how to deal with the mental illness that goes on in the park downtown?
So NAMI has an entire division of faith-based resources. They have bulletin inserts. They even have training. They're training they can access for faith-based. I can say that our mental health center has, on regular times, gone out to churches when there's an invitation to talk to churches.
Okay.
And we were just involved.
Yeah, we were just a couple of weeks ago at Mount Vernon on the west side, having like a mental health forum like you're wanting to do in your neighborhood. We work with everybody. I on Thursday morning just did a video with a pastor who is like working to change the stigma of mental illness within his community. So we helped him with that. No, we're collaborating with anybody and everybody who wants to. And that's why I alluded to being here and always going out and having meetings whenever.
So what would be called, what is Rebecca a resource or?
If it's homelessness, is that what you're asking?
We'd like to minister to the folks. We get deliver sandwiches and shower supplies,
I would check with Rebecca about, okay. And also, again, there's a professional blended homeless PBSO in town that you can access through Horizon House. But I would call Rebecca, and she can see what you need and kind of direct you.
The only reason I ask is because one of our prayer warriors was attacked.
Yeah.
And we didn't know how to handle it. I didn't want to call the police because I didn't know we had this program. But
and now you have my email.
Yeah.
Everybody has an email.
I get the tough job of trying to keep us on time and get us out of here at 7:30, and we've had some great questions. These beautiful ladies have said they will stick around for a few minutes if you guys have questions.